It is my great pleasure and privilege this morning to introduce playwright, educator, and fellow Wellesley sibling, Mfoniso Udofia. Ms. Udofia is a first-generation Nigerian-American storyteller who graduated from Wellesley in 2006 and went on to obtain her MFA from American Conservatory Theater in San Francisco. Ms. Udofia's plays have been developed, presented, and/or produced by over 17 professional companies and venues, including but not limited to Playwrights Realm, The Magic Theater, Dr. Barbara Ann Tier's National Black Theater, Sundance Theater Lab, American Slavery Project, Liberation Theater Company, and many more. She is Playwrights Realm's 2015-16 Page One Playwright, as well as the finalist of the 2015 Playwrights of New York Prize, the Eugene O'Neill National Playwrights Conference, Bay Area Playwrights Festival, to name just a few. She co-pioneered the youth initiative, the NIA Project, providing artistic outlets for youth residing in the Bayview, Hunts Point area. Two of Ms. Udofia's plays, Sojourners and Her Portmanteau, will be produced this coming spring, 2017, as part of New York Theater's workshop season, so be on the lookout for those. Currently, she's working on the Oregon Shakespeare Festival's Play On Commission, in which she's translating Shakespeare's Othello. She's also the artistic director of the Now Africa Playwrights Festival and a proud member of the New Dramatists Class of 2023. Ms. Udofia says her writing draws great influence and inspiration from the works of artists such as Ama Atayadu, Ben Okri, Wole Soyinka, Jocelyn Bio, and Donetta Grace, as well as from her parents who armed her with, and I quote, the stories, the skill, the dedication, and the sheer tenacity, unquote, to become the writer she is today. When asked in an interview what she would change about theater today, she remarks, more plays from more voices, more international theater. Please join me in welcoming our Wellesley sibling and acclaimed international playwright.
I struggled mightily with what I was gonna talk to you all about today. And I bounced between a lot of ideas. So many ideas that I think it's a little ridiculous, really. And I have had to sit with myself and ask myself why and what. What was making me so afraid? Why was I so afraid to do the very thing that theater practitioners always do? Just talk. There are many reasons why I was afraid, as I find myself facing a many-tiered fear. First, I am only 32 years old, and I still feel like I am 18. Maybe I feel more like I'm 25, not quite 18, but in some ways, I still feel and I am ridiculously young, and I've learned that sometimes I judge that. It feels more like I should be taking a course with you all and not giving one. Also related to the fear of, I think it's a fear of growing up, like a Peter Pan-like fear, is the fear of going against a certain kind of conditioning. It's a conditioning that I have nurtured, and in retrospect, it's a conditioning that keeps me small. And thus very comfortable, and importantly, it keeps me safe. I really love safety, even as I recognize there might be a stagnancy in that same safety. So I must admit that walking into my alma mater, one of the most rigorous, intellectually rigorous institutions in the nation, as an instructor and as a speaker and not as a student, is just not my idea of safe. Because I remember who I was when I was here. I pushed and contested absolutely anything with an opinion. And if I did that, then you all could turn around and do that to me now. One or more or all of you might could push and contest my thought, my delivery, my talk, and whatever this talk is gonna be. And that, if I am honest, that in my weaker moments could render me irrelevant if I allow myself that particular spiral. So it's not safe. And perhaps most frightening, like the most frightening, was the realization that every single iteration of the various versions of this talk that I had been scaffolding had me circling around issues of identity within the American theater. every single iteration exposed my own tension with my own identity within the American theater, or the American theater's tension with my identity expression. There's always like this big old tension. And my talks were leading me further and further into exposing and naming issues with a field I absolutely adore. I discovered that I was exposing that the field that I adore and that I chose is sometimes wholly unprepared to choose me. In order to expose the theater that I love, my talks also had me exposing myself. Yet again, and publicly, yet again, I had to yet again call attention to the nuances in my blackness, in my Africanness, in my womanness, in order to throw how the American theater renders marginalized bodies into relief. So you can see the operation of that theater in the world. One talk had me opening with how the theater faces the same problem as America itself. They are both entities that crosshairs with their own intention. We are the land of the free and the home of the brave, proclaims America, yet historically, how well have we done with that? The theater proclaims itself to be the house of all stories. It proclaims it loudly, mightily, but historically, how well has the theater done with that? Not well, my friends, not well at all. So my potential talks frightened the living out of me. I threw so many of them away in abject fear, because who wants to say out loud to a room of people they barely know that what they love, what they breathe for, if they are not careful, could annihilate their spirit? No one. Plus, I restate that you all are smart, so I was also trying to find a structure to hold all these concepts and be seen as marginally right. Oh my God, I was failing so hard. It was a crisis. Like, it's my crisis. I am still mid-crisis. I stand in front of you mid-crisis. And I'm also a little bit tired of being scared. So I decided as of Monday afternoon that this talk is going to be as messy as I feel. I'm going to read from my paper a lot to anchor me. If I'm scared of a story in the moment, I will just simply tell you that I'm scared. I will also be informal, or as informal as I actually am. So sometimes I will deviate and be sporadic and nonlinear, and you all will hate me or love me, we'll see. I was trying to put on some sort of professional suit, whatever that means, and it's just awkward. I'm an artist, so it is what it is when it is what it is. And I'm also going to be very personal, a little less academic, because that's what I got, and I have had to learn to value that. Hopefully I will be enlightening, because as you listen to me, perhaps you can take stock of yourself and see how you guys will walk through the world. The name of this talk, or whatever this thing is going to be this morning, is Invisible Identities and the Curious State of Theater in the United States of America. You will note that this is not exactly the title that is in your pamphlets or brochures or even what you may have been told. I told you the truth when I told you that fear had me tiptoeing and frustrated, so lo and behold, it's a new title. And yes, I'm also really going to begin this hour-long thing by first identifying myself. Thank you, Lily, for opening the space for me. I appreciate you mightily. I just have to do this part on my own because it's pertinent to this talk thing we're about to embark on. Okay, here goes. My name is Mfoniso Udofia. The name means the luck of God. I'm 32 years old. I am a first-generation Nigerian Ibibio American cisgendered queer woman of color. I am a Wellesley woman, class of 2006. I have my master's in acting from the American Conservatory Theater. I have founded and helmed two companies, the NEA Project, which provided free arts education to youth of color by arts practitioners of color in the Bayview Hunters Point area of San Francisco, California. And I also run the Now Africa Playwrights Festival, a home and burgeoning archival center for African dramatic artists. I and many members of my family suffer from depression. I am now combating it with all of the therapies and all of the joy seeking. I am also a musician, 7 years of wind ensemble and jazz trombone and 6 years of opera training. I'm a lyric soprano, no matter how deep this voice sounds to you now. I love my thickness. I've learned to love that. And in 2009, it became my explicit mission to create authentic, nuanced literature and roles for Africans within the American United States theater. That is how I would identify myself today. I left things out for time's sake because those things, identities, they are long things. But I uncovered the most important things, I hope, I think, we'll see. And I do that for myself, that sort of identification. I do that sometimes loudly. Sometimes I do it softly. Sometimes I just do it to myself. And I do it so that I can remember who I am when I am in rooms. Hostile rooms, uncaring rooms, or even worse sometimes, really supportive rooms. I found for me personally that I need to remember myself even more when I'm being supported because that's when I like to forget myself the most. And part of my identity is that I'm Mfoniso Udofia, choose to make myself walk right into the heart of fear, especially when I become aware that it is fear that is wreaking havoc on my body. So this talk, Invisible Identities and the Curious State of Theater in the United States of America, is a compilation of all the talks that I was going to give. Let's begin part one. Coming to know yourself. I said that this was going to be personal. If y'all get weary, y'all can be like, oh God, I'm funny, so I'm weary, and we can like take a little pause. But part one, we'll start now. Before 2009, I did not think critically or even much about how I functioned in the world. And if I did, it was a thinner sort of thinking. Memory is a tricky thing, so I don't know if I can really remember exactly everything about myself at 24 years old, but I look back and I understand I was really fragile in very key certain ways. I cared if people loved me and how they loved me. I cared if I was seen as smart. I cared about other people's beauty standards. I was living exactly for my parents. I had everyone else's identity inside of me and not enough room for my own. And as you can see from how I opened up this talk chronicling fear, specifically you can see how one of my fears was how you all might judge me. This is a chronic condition I suffer from. But at 24, I don't know if I could have found the center of me. No capacity to. So when I graduated from acting school at the Tony Award winning American Conservatory Theater in 2009 and moved to New York City with only $800 in my pocket in the middle of the worst economic crisis since the Great Depression and without a center and an inability to see, know, and hold myself, oh my God, I was in for it. I got to New York City. Luckily, I had had an exemplary showcase and secured many meetings with agents, and I have a meeting with my first agent. Sitting there, young, ready. I mean, I was so ready. She asks me if I can sing. I say, yes, I can. And I can sing very well. She then says she has appointments for me yesterday. I'm perfect. I'm like, yes, I am. I am. And I am ready. She told me I was perfect to play the part of Gary Coleman in the musical Avenue Q. Or if not that, then Dreamgirls was having a big comeback regionally and I would make a great Effie. Do you all know those parts in theater? Okay, well then I won't unpack those parts. But there's a very specific black woman that plays these parts. I told her I sing opera. I was trained at Wellesley. And I can sing a great Christine from Phantom of the Opera. And actually, I can sing any real soprano parts, really. I found out, though, that girls like me don't sing soprano. They better wail down a house, which I cannot do in that way. The meeting was quickly over. No worries. I'm still able to get an agent. I'm also working as a freelance educator in foster homes and in Chelsea projects, bringing arts educations to underserved communities. And in spare moments, I work sample sales. I work retail. I sell $3,000 Hermes scarves and $10,000 Lalique crystal vases while making $10 an hour. But it's okay. We're good. It's good. It's all good. I have an agent, and I'm not booking anything. Not a part. So I tell my agent that the reason that I am not booking jobs is because they're sending me out for sassy black girls. I mean, I can do that, but there are girls that can do that far better. I am more sweet than sass. Well, back then anyway. Now, I don't know, it's a whole different thing. But back then, I was more sweet than sass. So agent, please send me out for sweet. There was an audition coming up for A Christmas Carol, and I knew that I could play the part of Belle. I told my agent, send me out for Belle. Belle, Belle in A Christmas Carol. I wanted to play Belle in A Christmas Carol at a regional theater in New Jersey. Belle, the sweet ingenue. Scrooge's former girlfriend, the apple of somebody's eye, beautiful and desirable. And my agent balked at me, telling me to my face, you're not Belle. I deeply believe my agent was confused. And we fought. I demanded my agent put me in contention for Belle. I got there, saw who casting was sending in for the role, and I realized and told myself in that moment in 2009, I actually am not Belle. I murdered that audition. It was so good. But there was no way I got to play the part. I was not thin enough. I was not fair enough. I was sweet, but I was not the right kind of sweet. Then the worst thing happened in 2010. It's the thing that had me temporarily putting acting on hold. I auditioned for Ruined almost 10 times. Do you all know this play, Ruined? Okay, so let me break down this play, Ruined, just a little bit. Ruined is by Lynn Nottage. She is a MacArthur genius. She won the Pulitzer Prize for this play in 2009, and it's an adaptation of Bertolt Brecht's Mother Courage set in the Congo in a brothel. And the women, the term ruined comes from what happens to female bodies in times of pillage and plunder. Usually the war kind of transmutes itself onto the female. And these are women whose it's female genital mutilation. They've been carved out. And my family, just like a little historic, I am the grandchild of the Biafran War. My parents saw and lived through the Biafran War in Nigeria, often termed the first modern African civil war. So I do have a lot of war stories in my brain. I understand some of the violence of it, as war doesn't just affect the generation in which it occurs, it also affects the children. So I've seen what happens to the women. And I read this play and I went, yeah, okay, maybe I can't be Belle. Maybe I can't sing Christine, but I can be an African. I can do that. And granted, the Congo is not Nigeria, but I saw this picture. I did so much research for this. There's this picture of this woman who one of the parts is based on. The name is Salima. And when I saw this picture, I went, yeah, cool. With my skill, I can do it. She's actually not starving. She's got pain in her eyes because she's seen a lot. But she's standing up. She's not wailing at you. This reminded me of my aunt. And so I went in, and I did so well yet again. And one of the directors was like, you're not quite African enough. And I looked at that picture, and I looked at myself, and I went, okay, I can't be Belle. I can't be Christine, but I can't be African either. They're like, we're going for a certain kind of look. I was like, I've seen the pictures of the women that were interviewed for the play. I am the look. They were like, nope. We're looking for something waifish. I was like, you're looking for something broken. I did that almost 10 times before I could not do it anymore. I was devastated. And I learned so much about myself in that year-long time span. This is what I learned. I learned I'm not sweet. I learned I'm not fair. I learned that I should be able to sing gospel better than opera. I learned I'm not Belle. I learned I'm not African enough to play an African. I learned that really I'm Gary Coleman. I was so confused and depressed. And I did not yet have a center to draw upon to know who I was. So I was everything and anything anyone told me I was. And that's when I first started writing plays. My first play, The Grove, was not intended for public consumption. It was intended for me to process what was happening to my body. The act of writing became my act of identification. My play, The Grove, taught me, it reminded me, it clarified for me who I was. My name is Mfoniso Udofia. I'm a first generation Nigerian Ibibio American queer woman. I and many of my members of my family suffer from mental illness, mine specifically being depression. I love the arts, I'm thick, I'm plush, I am sexual, I am sensual, so I wrote Adiaga. She was a first generation Ibibio American queer woman. Her father suffered from paranoid schizophrenia born out of the Biafran War, but they were located in America. She was in love with a woman and she was thick and that was not the issue. And she was also unable to form sentences because it frightened her to say too loudly who she was. I wrote myself down and I called it Adiaga Ufot, but it was so me. I looked up from that play to see if I could find another version of myself with all those intersections in the theater beyond what I had written. And then I got angry. This was a different kind of anger. It was an anger born from the ghost of knowing yourself. Because it made me really look at Ruined. The only African plays I could find were African like poverty porn plays. I really looked at Ruined, and while I will defend its right to exist, I'm like, there've got to be other things than women who've been excavated from the inside out, singing in brothels for men in front of all white audiences. There's got to be something else. So, okay, let me look. The only other thing I could find around that time was The Lion King. That was the only other African play out there for me to see. The Lion King, where all the characters are animals, based on Shakespeare's Hamlet, set in East Africa, but some of the songs are so South African, like Wimowe, that is a South African lullaby. I mean, God help me, G, whenever I watch The Lion King and I hear The Lion Sleeps Tonight, I'm like, do we? We don't know. So maybe these are globalized lions. Maybe that's what The Lion King is trying to tell me. Or maybe it's just poor research. I don't know. I looked up at my theater landscape, saw what I had written, started forming the ghost of an identity, and for the first time entered pain. Part two, the theater itself. Now, I wasn't expecting to feel the pain quite as keenly as I did. I didn't recognize it in 2009, but I had expected more from the theater, and I wanted more for myself. That was the nature of what that pain was, and why I fell into the depression I fell into. Now, writing The Grove helped illuminate identity. and it caused parts of the depression, not all of it, but I, how do I say this? I began to realize that I saw the theater as a great equalizer. Who here goes to the theater? Amazing. For me, I had been taught and I had bought the rhetoric hook, line, and sinker that the theater is where masses go to see themselves. And if the theater is working most optimally, then the theater is where the masses go to see, process, in a safe space, how potential change could look. That's what the theater purports to do. I checked theater mission statements to make sure I wasn't insane. Let's take a look at Manhattan Theater Club's mission, or I'll read it to you. Manhattan Theater Club, one of the preeminent off-Broadway houses in New York City, says, our mission at MTC is to produce a season of innovative work with a series of productions as broad and as diverse as New York itself. That's the mission. It is everywhere. I can feel good saying this, even though I know maybe one day MTC might call me. We'll see. This is being recorded. I'm sorry, but it's true. That is their mission. In 2015, like 2 years ago, but really a year and like what, 11 days ago, the New York Times published a piece by Laura Collins Hughes that began, the outrage began before Manhattan Theater Club had unveiled its full 2015-16 season. Seven of its planned 8 plays had been announced, all of them written by white men. In response to the season, playwright Christopher Diaz referred to the company's stated mission of producing work as broad and as diverse as New York itself by tweeting, I would love to discuss strategies for approaching your goal. To which the artistic director of the theater, a woman, which was disheartening to me, I will say, Lynn Meadows states, I don't deny the fact of this season is anomalous in terms of the percentage of diversity on our stages. It's just how the season came together. That's 2015. Imagine what was happening to my body in 2009. And there are no stats on how and when we produce diverse theater. And if this is diversity, or diversity for diversity's sake, which I then go, is pandering. Take, for instance, the theater companies that only produce one black play in a season around the month of February. And it's usually either a Raisin in the Sun or an August Wilson play and not King Hedley because that play is too weird. Is that diversity or is that pandering? Or is this something to celebrate? Do we call this diversity? Paulson writes in the New York Times, during the theater season of 2014 to 15, about 30% of the roles at the city's most prominent theaters went to minority actors, up 24%. I was like, yes, yes, that's so good. And then I read the next paragraph. For Asian American actors, a single Broadway show, the Lincoln Center Theater Revival of The King and I, was responsible for half the jobs that season. So now I don't know if I'm applauding or crying, because that's only one show, The King and I, and that's what employed half the Asians that season. And I was alluding to it before, but I did, I went through and I saw so many African plays, like ground floor readings, and I just decided that it is not diversity if I can't actually see an African common man. I cannot see another African child bride, an African child soldier, an African child anything that children should not be doing. I cannot see another play on African female genital mutilation, an epic everlasting African war with refugees, and drums, incongruous drums. Do you know that I can hear through drums? I cannot see another play with African drums set in Kenya, but they're using South African rhythms. I cannot. That is not diversity. That is some sort of pat me on the back, tell me we're good, blink your eye and go back to your organizational infrastructure of dispossessing me. The Guardian wrote my favorite thing on August 22nd, 2015. Alexis Solosky wrote, and please remember Alexis's name because we will come back to her. She wrote that the new Broadway season includes no new plays by women or writers of color. Please note, if any of you are theater heads, Jitney just opened up on Broadway. That's written by August Wilson. This came out August 22nd, 2015. So just keep that in your mind. So she says the new Broadway season includes no new plays by women or writers of color, no old ones either. The picture for musicals is a little rosier, but not a lot. Off-Broadway is somewhat better, but nothing like parody. As reported in American Theater, last season, less than a quarter of plays produced in America and written in the last 50 years were by women, despite women making up a preponderance of the theater-going population. An accounting of the previous three seasons showed only 12% of American plays were penned by writers of color. Now, okay, this is my voice coming into Alexis right now, an American Theater magazine. Penned? Do you mean produced? Or do you mean penned? Because I know so many of us who are writing. Anyway, back in. Why does theater have such a problem in terms of gender and race? Much of it may have to do with history. Shakespeare remains by far the most produced playwright and still informs our vision of what a playwright should look and be. It's plays by white men that fill the syllabi for our theater history and literature courses from the Greeks on. Most revivals are of plays by white men because most previous plays are written by white men. Really? Okay, but yes, okay. And many theaters make the assumption, right or wrong, that those are the plays audiences want to be. What this taught me is I need to become a statistician. And it also taught me they're not seeing me. They're not seeing the ground, all the people who are actually writing. We still, in 2017, laud Shakespeare as the ultimate end all be all. All of this is going on while, let me pull another theater mission for you. This is from the Roundabout Theater in New York. We have theater still telling me to my face that we are committed to producing the highest quality theater with the finest artists, sharing stories that endure and providing accessibility to all audiences. Hence depression. Oh my God, hence the depression. I was in a hostile home. And some of you all understand what it might be to be within a hostile home. A home that purported to love and serve, yet curiously could not and would not see. So now I'm going to go into what the hard thing was. After writing The Grove, this is part three, and realizing the theater for what it was and its limitations in meeting its own lofty goals, I made it my explicit mission to create space for myself and other selves like me. This began my research phase, and that's when I stumbled across Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. Y'all know her? Great. Well, she was a commencement speaker here. Okay, have you all heard The Danger of a Single Story? Great. Well, I still think it bears repeating, so we are going to watch a clip of it and remind ourselves. Because for me, in 2009 this came out, for me, around the time of my crisis, she put so eloquently into words what I wanted to do, but specifically within the theater. Let's just watch like the first 8 minutes of her. That woman gave me my best life in 2009. She had so eloquently put into words my struggle. The same struggle I was having in theater. Now hers is definitely in the world of books, novels, essays. We don't have anyone talking this way about the theater itself, even though the same thing is happening. And she was my lifeline. I transposed this talk for myself in my head. And I moved it away from the literary world into the theater world, and Alan Locke became William Shakespeare for me, actually. And it's funny because Lily, you brought up that I am working on a translation of Othello right now that's running through the Oregon Shakespeare Festival, the biggest Shakespeare festival in the nation. I got a very sizable amount of money to translate this play, and two dramaturgs are researchers for theater, to help me frame Shakespeare And I hate this play. I hate it, I hate it, I hate it. And just like she's talking about Alan Locke, who we have been, I mean, most of us know and have been taught, and most of us know and have been taught Shakespeare, I am pouring through Othello as they're making the beast of two backs. And every time you talk about Othello, he's referenced to as an animal. And I'm like, Shakespeare did not write a two-dimensional black man. He wrote a manual on how to dispossess. And so it is so, oh, she was so good for me to understand where I'm at right now. And I re-watched this a lot. And I realized there is just one part of it missing for me. And she can't get into it right now because it's 18 minutes and it's a TED Talk. So we have to, we have to be bracketed about it. But the part of this speech that I was missing, especially in 2009, as I'm beginning to identify myself, understand the theater that I'm in, and try to move and create honest theater works for myself, I didn't know how. Like I said, The Grove, I wrote for myself. I did not write this for other people to consume. In fact, if I'm going to be honest, my partner at the time thought it was so good, she started shopping it out to other theaters behind my back, and all of a sudden, other people were consuming The Grove before I was ready for that to happen. And I was so confused because I wanted to do desperately what Chimamanda says we need to do, which is make pluralistic stories. But my identities were hard enough for me to hold in private. I am African, and I am queer. I have read so many articles about how being African and queer, how to be African is to not be queer, how my own blood rises up against me. In private, I am going through it already. How do I do what Chimamanda says to do? Because that's going to mean I'm going to have to bring my private self, if I am actually writing a plural story the way I see it, into the public sphere. The way I did it was I clung really, really hard to Chimamanda. Really hard, going, I know you can't tell me all the things because you had 18 minutes, but I'm going to read everything you wrote and then find out who else you read. And one of the people that I stumbled across was Binyavanga Wainaina. Y'all know him? Okay, I see some people who do know him. This man became another hero for me, and it's actually in him that I understood the how. He is a Kenyan author and activist. He is gay. He is African Kenyan. He has AIDS. And he talks about it. And I've watched the way people deal with him and how this man rallies himself to keep coming to the center. So the how for me, there is no way I discovered through watching Binyavanga Wainaina except by deciding to. And I got to watch a man do it in real time in front of me. And he's not dead yet. He might, because the way people can hate him is mighty. But he decides to. And I watched those pauses in his speech as he decides to say the thing that I think is ripping him apart. And I bless that man because he is my how-to manual for how to possess. So that's my how. And what I want to impart to you is that identification is so important, but it's merely the first revolutionary step in the revolutionary process. You will identify yourself before others identify you and tell you that you are Gary Coleman. So identify yourself. You will understand the frame in which you are deciding to work, the institutions that you are walking into, and you will look at them without the rose-colored glasses and without the rhetoric that they are giving to you. Look at them for what they are. you will find some heroes to cling to. And you will discover, in looking at those heroes, you will find other heroes that'll teach you how every day in their mere existence. Part four, the research began. So by this time, I have Binyavanga Wainaina and I have Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. I know what the theater is trying to do to me, and I have my identity, so I think, and it's an amorphous thing. Some days I'm putting down queer, sometimes I'm picking it up. Some days I'm putting down black and picking it up. I do crazy things month to month, but I know what I'm doing, I think. And I am not as depressed, I hope. And I am doing this playwriting thing I wanted to do, and I'm struggling, but I do it, and I succeed, and I get writer's block one day. And I'm like, well, nobody writes like me. Not in this genre, not in this field. I'm the only one who writes the way that I write. Oh, what arrogance I had. It was my father, it was his voice that like pierced through me, that was like, you know, you don't come from nowhere. Such an African man. You don't know where you come from. You don't come from nowhere. And I'm sitting there going, well, maybe I'll read an African play. Because Binyavanga Wainaina and Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie don't write plays. They're helping me rhetorically understand myself. But who are the playwrights that do what I've done? And why am I operating as if I'm ahistorical? So I go and I think first. And I go, okay, Mfoniso, name 10 women playwrights. I think I said to myself, Paula Vogel and Sarah Rule. That was it. Name 10 black women playwrights. Lorraine Hansberry. Shoot. Name 10 queer playwrights. Oh, God. Name 10 African playwrights. Crickets. I mean, I think I said Wole Soyinka and Athol Fugard. And then I started going, okay, name intersections, the intersections you live at. Can you name a woman African playwright? Can you name a woman, a queer woman African playwright? Oh my God, I could do none of those things. And that's when I had to start researching. Because as you find yourself in certain rooms, especially as if you are marginalized in any way, and all of us are women, so you're gonna walk into rooms right away where, you know, people are going to think something about your womanness, so that goes for all of us. But adding those intersections together, as you walk into a room, you have to know that you're not the first person to do so. And that there might actually be a legacy behind you. And that the way systems of oppression can work is to make you not think to think of your history. So I started researching. And I felt a little less odd in myself. And I want to tell you a little bit about what I discovered. There are playwrights that I now love. Ama Ata Aidu is a Ghanaian playwright who writes like me, actually. Would never have known pre-2013. Jocelyn Bio writes African comedies like slapstick. I've never seen Africans laughing on a stage. That rocked my world. Donata Lavinia Grays is from the American South. I was born in Texas. And she's a queer woman. She writes black queer women with ferocity. Nick Mwalko is a transgender Tanzanian playwright. There's a transgender Tanzanian playwright, y'all. These people are facing some of the same struggles I am. And I read their plays and I feel at home. And I realize that I can actually make my home within an institution. I don't just have to see the dispossession. I can possess myself. And I add that to African classic writers that I never think about, because you never see them, but I know them. Wole Soyinka, Athol Fugard, Femi Uba, Ola Rotimi. That is literature that's actually also doing what Chimamanda is asking us to do. I'm not the only one, it's just you don't see them. That's how I also started to value my own form. Because what I'm gonna talk about next will be how once you see yourself, an institution might try to unsee you while you know yourself. And from these people, I was able to understand what it is I do. So this is like the last part, and then I'll be wrapping up. And a play I wrote called Run Boy Run, which they told me cannot begin the way I have begun it. I'll read that to you, tell you to your faces I'm not changing the way I'm beginning this play. I can tell you why I'm not changing the way I'm beginning this play. And then we can open it up for questions, if you have any, whatever they may be. So this is from Run Boy Run, and I'm going to speak like my people. It all began in black. Before this world was our world, it was pitch. Sky not yet separate from earth. Nothing firm enough to imagine firmament. Everything's were nothing, and some things were all things. Entire eternity swelling and balancing black. It was black. And then a single question, a tiny wonder, a small smatter of a thought, and this black, this wholeness, it began to contemplate itself, wanting to see itself, to behold all of its entire self. The questioning so earnest, that the black, it began to laugh, splitting itself to pieces. Its wonder so deep that the black, began to cry, washing itself across distances. Its thought so dangerous, so singular, that the black, it began to shout. Its once glorious form was hollowing, pocking, moldering. Every rumbling ache in the belly of this it created the stars. It created the trees, the seeds. Hey! And when its last chocolatier shout died, black looked and saw that in its desire it had become the light. From there, from divine broken came our world. It's from that that we come to know ourselves. So that's the opening to Run Boy Run. And that's the conjuring people want to change. Because well-made plays don't begin that way. But mine does. And it is quite well-made.